Hello and welcome back to the course on Introduction to Solid State Physics. We will discuss the next module in the prescribed syllabus, that is the electronic band structure. Basically, we are going to discuss how the electrons are moving inside a crystal. Already we have an idea about the structure of the crystal and how the atoms are arranged inside a solid. Based on that, we'll develop the electronic band structure, and based on this we'll be discussing about the electronic properties of the solids. Before going into that, let us look at the solid in its holistic picture. We know that the solid contains the ions and the electrons. So that is the basic constituents of a solid at the low energy physics regime. And the ions are having heavier mass and they are almost immobile compared with the motion of the electrons. The electrons are having lighter mass and they are mobile. Although the ions can move about their equilibrium position, as has been discussed in our previous module where we studied about the lattice vibration, but that motion is very much small compared to the free motion of the electrons, especially the conduction electrons. And in quantum mechanics, we know that the basic tool that can be used to study the properties of a solid is Schrödinger equation, and the basic formalism or the basic equation for this is h cap psi is equal to e psi, where h is the Hamiltonian operator. It has got two components. It is the kinetic energy component, that is minus h cross square by 2m into delta square, plus the potential energy component plus V times psi is equal to E psi. So this is what is the basic tool that is described in quantum mechanics. Now let us write this Schrödinger equation for a solid which contains ions and the electrons. Now let us see that the wave function is going to depend on the position coordinates of the electrons, which are designated by small r, and also that of the ions. Even though the motion of the ions is very much limited, but that is not zero. So the coordinates of the ions are denoted by capital R, and the coordinates of the electrons are denoted by small r. This is the way we can write this Schrödinger equation. Now let us write this Hamiltonian part by breaking it into the kinetic energy operator and the potential energy operator. Now there are two kinds of motion here. One is the electronic motion, other one is the ionic motion, and both of them will contribute to the kinetic energy. So let us do that. So this is the way we can represent the kinetic energy of the electrons, that is minus h cross square by 2m summation over all the electrons. Suppose there are n number of electrons here and there are m number of ions. So in this manner we can represent the kinetic energy of the electrons and that of the ions. Me is the mass of the electron and capital M I is the mass of the ith ion. So in this manner we can represent the kinetic energy of the electrons and that of the ions. Now when we look at the solid, let us go back to the previous slide here. So as I told, the solid contains two entities, the electrons and the ions, and both are charged particles. So there can be three different types of interaction between these two spaces. One is the electron-electron interaction, then electron-ion interaction, and ion-ion interaction. So there can be three types of interaction between these two species which are charged. Basically, these are Coulombic interactions. And we know that the Coulombic potential energy can be represented as the charged of these two species, that is Q1, Q2, by the relative position between these two charged particles, that is Q1, Q2 by R. Now let us do that for these three species. The electron-electron interaction, if there are n number of electrons, we can write it like E square by modulus of Ri minus Rj. So here the summation runs over I equal to 1 to n and summation over j which is not equal to I from 1 to n. So why this term is here? So that we can have this Rij and Rji terms, they should not be repeated, because Rij and Rji terms basically they represent the same interaction. So we have to take out these terms for which j is not equal to i. So this is the way we can write the electron-electron interaction. Similarly, we can write the electron-ion interaction. So electron-electron interaction is repulsive, electron-ion interaction will be attractive. That's why there is a negative sign here. So similarly here, the index small I runs from 1 to n and the index capital I, which represents the ions, runs from 1 to m, because there are capital M number of ions and capital N number of electrons. So this is ions and N is the electrons, and the potential energy is Ze square by R. So this is the relative position between the electron and the ion, relative distance between the electron and the ion. Similarly, the last term is the ion-ion interaction. So it is equivalent in the form with that of the electron-electron interaction. Again, this is repulsive in nature, and here I runs from 1 to m and j not equal to I runs from 1 to m. So it is Zi Zj E square by Ri minus Rj, because each ion is having a charge of Ze, Zie, Zj, Z1e, Z2e, like this we can have the charge of the ions. So the ion-ion interaction can be represented as Zi Zj E square by Ri minus Rj summed over all the ions. Now this is the complicated Hamiltonian of the solid, which is thought to be having the ions and the electrons. Now this kind of equation, here is the Hamiltonian which has been written here, and this is a very complex Hamiltonian and it is a many body problem. And we know from our basic quantum mechanics that only the two body problem can be solved analytically. That is, the example is the hydrogen atom problem, which can be solved analytically, whereas numerically it is very, very difficult to solve this complex many body problem, which is having around 10 to the power 22 equations. Why it is so? So let us take the example for solid sodium, which is a metal, and suppose the valence electron, its valency is 1, and we know that in a solid, in 1 centimeter cube of solid, we are having 10 to the power 22 atoms, roughly 10 to the power 22 atoms of sodium in 1 centimeter cube of solid. That means there are 10 to the power 22 ions and roughly 10 to the power 22 number of electrons, and each is having 3 degrees of freedom. If you talk about the Cartesian coordinate system, then x, y, z coordinates are there. So similarly, we can have around 3 into 10 to the power 22 coupled differential equation, and to solve it we need the similar number of constants. So it is almost literally impossible to solve it numerically even with the most advanced computers. So this is the basic problem when we deal with the solids. So now how to solve it, because this Schrödinger equation ab initio cannot be solved, so we have to take some approximations. And the first approximation already we have discussed in our earlier module, that is what we call it as the free electron theory. So already we have discussed the free electron theory, where we assumed the electrons to be some sort of gas, and we have discussed both the classical as well as the quantum mechanical treatment, that is a Drude and Drude Sommerfeld theory for the free electron gas. But one of the major demerits of the Drude Sommerfeld theory is that we cannot distinguish between the conductors and insulators. Why some materials are having high conductivity and why some materials are having very low conductivity, that cannot be explained using the Drude Sommerfeld theory, which is based on the free electron gas. And what is the assumption here in the Drude Sommerfeld theory? We had assumed the potential to be constant. We had assumed a constant potential over which the electron is moving freely inside the solid. Based on this, we had developed the properties of the solid. This theory holds good for the metals to explain certain properties, which has been discussed extensively in our first and second module. But many of the other properties cannot be explained, especially when we are going into the distinction between the metals, semiconductors and insulators. And the major reason for that is that we have ignored the periodicity of the lattice. How the ions are arranged inside the lattice, inside the solid, that has been completely ignored while discussing the Drude Sommerfeld model, because we have assumed a constant potential V over which the electrons are moving. So the electrons can be assumed to be almost free, and we had obtained the free electron solution to this, and always the constant potential, it can be referenced to zero, and we can rewrite the Schrödinger equation for this, that is delta square psi plus k square psi is equal to zero. So we had written it like this, delta square psi plus 2m by h cross square e minus v psi is equal to zero. Since v is constant, so that's why the solution will also be that of a free particle solution. And the solution can be written, the phase factor of the solution will contain this term k, where k is called as the wave vector. So basically here we are discussing about the electron waves or the wave packet associated with that of the moving electron. So here k square is related with the energy as 2me by h cross square, and it is the dot product of the wave vector on itself. K square is equal to k dot k, and it is related with the energy of the electron as 2me by h cross square, where e is the energy of the electron and it is entirely kinetic, because we have assumed the potential to be constant, which can be referenced to zero. Now when we plot the Venn diagram for this. So basically the Venn diagram is a relation between the energy and the wave vector k. It is also called as the dispersion relation for the electrons. Already we have discussed the phonon dispersion relation, which is basically the relation between the frequency of vibration and the wave vector q. This is what is called as the phonon dispersion. And similarly for the electrons, we can have the energy of the electrons, which basically is related with the frequency in this manner, E equal to h cross omega, which in fact is related with the wave vector k. So this feature comes from the wave nature of the electrons. The momentum of the electrons can be represented as P equal to h cross k, and the energy is equal to, for a free particle, is P square by 2m. The kinetic energy is equal to P square by 2m, which is basically h cross square k square by 2m. So the dispersion curve for the electrons inside a solid, when you assume the free electrons, it comes out to be a parabola, because when you plot a graph between energy and the wave vector k, it comes out to be parabola. This is what is called as the parabolic band. So this is what is the band picture for a completely free electron. And again, in this case, this mass m is the classical mass of the electron, as if it is moving freely in the absence of all other electrons and all other ions. But that is not the case. We know that the electron is moving in a sea of other electrons and the periodically arranged ions. So if you can draw a pictorial representation of this, suppose this is one dimension. We have the ions, and surrounding these ions we are having the associated potential of this manner. So the electron wave is moving inside this, having a wavelength of lambda, inside this periodic potential, which we had completely ignored while discussing the Drude Sommerfeld theory. So this is the wave vector k, and it is having some periodicity with the lattice translational vector t. So now when you consider the motion of the electrons in case of the periodic potential, we'll see how the plane wave solution is going to be modified. So here, this is what is the solution for the free electrons when we assume a constant potential experienced by it, that is around e to the power I k dot r, with some normalization factor which we have not mentioned it here. So psi is roughly equal to exponential I into k dot r, which is basically the solution to a free particle, and it is called as the free plane wave solution for the electron wave function. So how to give the impact of this periodic potential? For this, let us follow a very simple but effective approach. So what you are going to assume is that the electron is moving in an effective potential. So let us concentrate on the motion of a single electron, and this electron is moving in an effective potential, and this potential is created by all other ions and all other valence electrons. So here ions means ions also contains the core electrons. It the core electrons are not free to move, so they are attached to the ions. So the effective potential in which the single electron is moving is generated by all other ions with the core electrons and all other valence electrons. And this potential must follow the periodicity of the lattice. So if T is the lattice translational vector, we know from the module 3 how the lattice gets itself repeated, how the unit cell gets itself repeated through the lattice translational vector. So here T is the lattice translational vector. So since the lattice follows this periodicity, the potential generated by the ions and the core electrons must also follow the same periodicity. That is, Vr will be equal to Vr plus T, where V is the effective potential due to all ions plus core electrons and all other valence electrons. In this potential, this single electron is moving. And this idea, here T is equal to N1A plus N2B plus N3C, where A, B, C are the basis vectors and N1, N2, N3 are the integers. So based on the periodicity of the lattice, we can see that the potential is also periodic, and it follows the relation Vr is equal to Vr plus T. And this mechanism or this kind of philosophy was first of all introduced by Bloch. So now under this we can assume the motion of the electrons, and we'll assume the same EK diagram, because only thing that we have changed from the free electron theory is that the potential is periodic. That is the only change we have done it here. So we can assume the same EK relation, but we have to impose the periodic potential on it. So we are having the same plane wave solution, but this solution will be modulated by another periodic function. So we have to modify this relation with another periodic function which follows the same periodicity as that of the lattice. We cannot take this exactly the same solution, the plane wave solution, but this plane wave solution has to be modified with another periodic function which follows the same periodicity as that of the lattice. And the relation E equal to h cross square k square by 2m will be taken as such, but you have to impose again the effect of the periodic potential on it. Now let us see how we can approach to that. As I mentioned, this idea was given by Felix Bloch, who was a Swiss physicist, and that is what is called as the Bloch theorem. So the solution to this Schrödinger equation in a periodic potential takes the form of a plane wave, and this plane wave is modulated by a periodic function. That is what we are going to do it. Now let us look at the solution. Let us first define what is this Bloch electrons. So basically this Bloch electrons are the electrons which obey the one electron Schrödinger equation in a periodic potential. So now the potential is periodic, and this one electron is moving in an effective potential V with the same periodicity as that of the lattice. So these electrons, they obey this one electron Schrödinger equation under a periodic potential, and these are called as the Bloch electrons. And the solution to this can be written as a plane wave solution together with a periodic function UKR, and this UKR follows the same periodicity as that of the lattice and that of the potential. So Vr is equal to Vr plus T. Similarly, UKR also is equal to uk r plus t. So the change that we have done it here from the plane wave solution is that we have included another periodic function to account for the effect of the periodicity of the potential. Now let us check the periodicity of this wave function which is attached to the electron which obeys the Schrödinger equation in a periodic potential. That means what will be psi k r plus t. When we write psi k r plus t, that means we have to replace r with r plus t. So e to the power I k dot r will be now e to the power I k dot r plus t times u k r plus t, and this u k r plus t is u k r, which is a periodic function, and this e to the power I k dot r and e to the power I k dot t can be written as separate terms, and e to the power I k dot r times u k r is equal to psi k r. So this can be written as e to the power I k dot t times psi k r. It means that after we imposed or after we translated the unit cell, when you are going from one unit cell to the other unit cell, there is only one extra phase factor is coming. There is no change as such in the wave function, but it is accompanied by one extra phase factor, which is e to the power I k dot t, and this k vector is in the reciprocal space and the vector t is in the real space. Vector t is the lattice translational vector in the real space, and k is the wave vector which is having the dimension of 1 by length, and it is in the reciprocal space. And this kind of situation, when k is one of the vectors in the reciprocal space, one of the lattice translational vector in the reciprocal space, that is g, then psi k r plus t will be equal to psi k r, because we know that e to the power I g dot t is equal to 1. So only for certain special values of this k, only and only when k is equal to g, then only this periodicity is exactly written. That means psi k r plus t will be equal to psi k r. Otherwise we have to have include this additional phase factor into this. So for this today's lecture we will just stop here, and in the next class we will see that this vector k is not unique to a particular block electron. That we will prove in the next class. Thank you.